For Africa from Cape Town. We've assembled an all-star panel to address the subject of trade for you this afternoon. The subject that we are investigating, how can Africa grow its share of global trade over the next 25 years? So let me introduce first our panelists. Yonov Frederick Agah, Deputy Director General of the WTO. Sir Michael Rake, Chairman of BT Group and also President of the CBI, the Confederation of British Industry. Fatima Haram Acyl, Commissioner for Trade and Industry at the Africa Union. Jean-Louis Ekra, President and Chair of the Board of Directors at Africa Export Import Bank. And Bob Diamond, Founder and CEO of Atlas Merchant Capital. So an all-star cast assembled from throughout Africa and further afield as well. If I could just set out some of the context to this conversation, it might be useful. The World Economic Forum has shown me that 12% of Africa go to African markets right now, and this is a way of introducing the idea of intra-Africa trade, and perhaps that's an area that we need to focus our conversation on today. African goods and services, they say, account for only 3% of value-added global trade. The WTO in 2014 said that this was the third straight year of below average trade growth, and they didn't see that changing in 2015. So all of those three statistics, just a way of illustrating the opportunity that exists for Africa to punch more strongly in the global trade agenda. So how can Africa share in that global trade pie a little more aggressively? So let's put that question to our panelists. I'll ask everybody to sort of set out their stalls just for a minute or so at the start of our conversation. And Yonov, perhaps we'll start with you.
Thank you, Anna. I think in general, trade performance for all countries and regions is a combination of external and internal domestic factors. You have to take into account access to foreign markets, the international global environment, as well as the behavior of your trading partners. Then when you come to your domestic situation, the kinds of trade policies that you put in place will define your performance in terms of exports and imports, the infrastructure that you need to support trade, and even the trade policy governance structure that you have in place that takes into account the interest of the business and private sector which you try to serve. Then you have to look at your macroeconomic environment, which makes you more competitive. You need to address infrastructural challenges, including issues relating to trade finance. So it's at the end of the day, is how a country, a region like Africa, manages the interaction of these external and domestic factors that would provide the frame as to how you benefit from the international trading system.
So that's the broad setup. So Mike, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's important first to look at this in the global context. If we look at the financial crisis of 2007, what happened immediately was a great reduction in trade, a huge increase in youth unemployment, a mistrust of institutions, whatever they might be, political or otherwise. And I think, you know, the development of protectionism, concern about immigration and people taking jobs, concerns about globalization, and all of this, I think we saw the Doha round, you know, not complete. And I think all of that's been very damaging potentially for the future. What's encouraging is we're now seeing an environment with regional agreements coming into place. The TPA has been given to the US government. We're seeing the TPP coming through, discussions in Japan, discussions in existence with Canada, the TTIP. So I think this is a real opportunity to move global trade forward and to understand that globalization can bring people out of poverty. So I think for South Africa, to your point, it's very, very important to have much more intra-African trade. So I think the tripartite trade agreement that's coming up, free trade agreement, is really important as a first step for Africa, you know, for the Cairo to Cape Town corridor to really be part of development for Africa as a whole, which then can engage with the EU, with others, in a global basis. I think it's a first step that will really help Africa move forward.
Yeah, no doubt we'll come back to that conversation about what Egypt is doing at the moment. Fatima, your thoughts?
Yes, I think that one of the things that African countries are really small to justify huge investment. For example, we all need roads, we need trade facilitation, we need the supply chain. we need to create, actually produce, and you know, a diversification. And continental free trade area is a very, very important aspect whereby we can have big, you know, market to justify huge amount of investment on the in the continent. We can have any firm from anywhere in this world can come and set up in Africa, and the market is there so that we can produce. So I think that basically we need to address, you know, the challenges, which is infrastructure, you know, the trade finance, you know, the productive capacities and so forth. And I think that we are very encouraged also with the free trade area of the tripartite, which is 26 countries, and it's going to be launched in June of 10 of June 2015. So I think that, you know, we can move forward.
Jean-Louis.
I would like to take it from a slightly different angle. When you look at total African trade, it has indeed grown tremendously over the past 20 to 50 years. To give you an order of idea, in 1993, that is when our African Bank was being created, total African trade was in the tune of $256 billion. As of last year, it was $1.4 trillion. It means that it has been growing. But the unfortunate thing is that it's still largely dominated by commodities. So very limited value addition locally, very, very limited retention of value of this export. That's why total African trade remains at about 3% of global trade. That's one of the factors. The other factor is that Africa is a continent that still trades less with itself. Although we've made giant strides in it, because it was about 7% before, it's now between 12 and 13%, still, it's quite low compared to Asia, which is like 55%, or even Europe, which is about 70%. So there are really efforts to do in that area. Another fact, which I would like also to bring, is that there's been a diversification in the partnership now. China has now overcome America as the single largest trader with Africa. And you have a great increase in trade with countries like India. Those are new elements which we believe are positive, but which needs to be harnessed through value addition of African exports.
Bob.
Thank you, Anna. I think it starts, you touched on this a bit with, is there a problem? And you mentioned that 10 to 12% of trade in Africa is kind of intra-Africa. 80% of the exports of African companies are overseas. The financial crisis has exacerbated the situation. About 50%, a little over than 50% of the trade finance that you mentioned came from European financial institutions prior to 2008. Because of Basel III, balkanization, capital needed in the home market, today it's very close to zero. So about 50% of trade finance that was coming from outside of Africa has needs to be replaced. So what can we do as institutions? In our institution in Atlas Mara, we based our whole business proposition on breaking down the model of taking a deposit and buying a T-bill, getting funds to the small businesses and the SMEs. And so we think strongly that intra-regional trade is what will pave the way for intra-Africa trade. And when I'm trying to think more positively, the progress that's being made now in the trade blocks, the four key trade blocks. In Francophone West Africa, there's now one set of banking rules. There's a single currency. The East African community is probably the furthest ahead, where the heads of state in Rwanda, in Uganda, and in Kenya are really paving the way around immigration, around transportation, around the potential for a single currency. So we're beginning to see some real focus on fostering intra-regional trade, and I think that's what will pave the way truly for intra-Africa trade.
Let's pick up there. We've had a number of really important topics sort of picked up in that first setting out of stalls, if you like. One of them is the global picture, the global context, the fact that we've had the WTO Doha round, that's stalled, and that's on the negative side. On the positive side, other trade agreements are being signed in Africa. The importance of intra-African trade has come through clearly there, the importance of getting the financing right, the importance of addressing what is traded. Jean-Louis was talking about this. So maybe we'll pick up on some of those things. If we look at the subject of intra-Africa trade and just how much of an issue is it at the moment and what is driving a lack of intra-Africa trade at the moment. I know, Fatima, the Africa Union, you've been pushing for a long time for more intra-African trade. Just set out for us why it's been so difficult to push forward intra-Africa trade.
I think, as I said, in order for us to understand why is the intra-African trade is slow, we have to understand what are the challenges. And some of these challenges are really, some of the trade facilitation. Now we signed the Bali Agreement, of course, and we're implementing the Bali Agreement, so we're that's part of the Bali package, the trade facilitation, and I'm happy to say that at least our member states are really working very hard to ensure that this is implemented. But actually, trade facilitation was also part of the decision of the head of state and government when they took that decision about boosting intra-African trade. It was felt that we really need to address this issue of trade facilitation, because if we don't address it, it's going to be very difficult. Sometimes we're talking about how do we connect Africa. And even if we connect Africa with trains or rails, if we have to stop at every border just to make sure that, we spend so much time to get the visa, it's going to be, basically useless. So it's very important that we address this thing. I think the other thing is really the, our production factor is very important. And I think that it's important, sometimes you will see in country A a surplus of, for example, food. And in country B, there is a shortage. So I think that it's very important that we also, open our border, we communicate, and it will also help us to, with the food security and so forth. It will help us with our diversification, the value chain approach. I mean, a country in Africa cannot come and say, okay, I want to really create, produce a car. How do we ensure that, some part is produced in country A, B, and C, and therefore we go and we have a product, made in Africa? So I think it's very important that we look at these issues. Again, as I said, the infrastructures, most our countries, the biggest one you can take Nigeria. But I think that most of our countries, our economies, are very, very small to justify huge number of investments. So I think that the infrastructure challenge is real. But how do we do this? So I think that it's very important that we look at the infrastructure. Oh, is there a problem with me?
I think it's just your hair was interfering with the microphone, perhaps.
Oh, okay.
Fatima. So, but
okay,
thank you.
So I think that it's very important that we look at, this context about, how do we address all these challenges so that we can go forward. The other thing that is very important also, our people are migrating. You see, people are dying on the seas and so forth. Yes, the root causes are various. Some of them may be political challenges, but most of them are actually economic opportunities. So I think that if we have a continental free trade area, if we really can, move within the continent of Africa, it will also promote movement of talent from one country to another.
Okay.
Countries such as Rwanda, the ECOWAS region, which is, the West African region, they have, free movement of people, and I think that they have really positive experiences. So when you look at the, advantages and disadvantages of having, free movement of people within the region, I think that the advantages outweigh, what's bad. So I think that it's very important that we look at these things on a more holistical way, and that's what we think that it's very important that we move forward. And we have actually a head of state and government of eight head of state, which are sharing the regional economic communities, looking at this issue every summit, which is mean every 6 months, and seeing how are we progressing on all of these aspects.
Okay, Jean-Louis, this is interesting in the context of your point. How do you boost intra-Africa trade? You were saying earlier, we need to move up the value chain. Africa needs to move up the value chain and produce not just commodities.
That's correct.
And it seems that in order to export to the neighbors, that might be necessary, but I guess which comes first?
Well, I believe right now what should come first is to have manufactured products that you can sell to your neighbor. Because take simple example, in West Africa, you have about four countries that produce about 80% of the cocoa of the world. Clearly, Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, which are the largest cocoa producers, cannot trade cocoa with each other. there won't be any need, except if this cocoa is turned into chocolate. Then you can sell to your neighbor. The other thing that seems not always well captured is the bulk of informal trade that is still happening among African countries. There's quite a lot that is happening. If you go to any border of countries, you'll see vibrancy, people moving back and forth. It's clearly they are moving because they are doing some trade, but that trade is still not captured. So one of these initiatives that we have in the bank is to create a platform, an electronic based on mobile telephony platform where payments could be made, and that way you will be able to capture part of that informal trade that is still happening among African countries.
Bob, I was reading the Africa Development Bank says that there's an unmet demand for bank intermediated trade finance between $110 and $120 billion dollars. So there's clearly a need out there for more trade finance that's not being met. What are the considerations around that? What are the ways that we try and fix that? You were referring to how some in the international banking community have moved away from Africa.
Yeah, particularly with the impact of Basel III and the financial crisis, how do we fill the void? And frankly, I don't think we can start by looking at the governments. We have to start by looking at the industry, at the finance industry, and at banks. And I think small businesses in most African countries would say that access to reasonably priced lending or finance is the single biggest issue that they face. And I certainly agree with that. So it starts with how do banks get, out of T-bills and into lending? How do we get money to small businesses, to entrepreneurs, to cross-border businesses? How do we take a sector like agriculture, which can be one of the greatest economic sectors in sub-Saharan Africa? Over 50% of the unused arable land in the world is right here in sub-Saharan Africa. And we need to have, more specialized lending units. We need to have our banks capable of helping the agricultural sector hedge next year's crop price with more sophisticated financing and risk management tools. There are a whole host of things available in banking that are not particularly innovative, but for here in Africa, for the smaller banks, they are. So one of the things is to try and bring in more tools that have been used in sectors like agriculture to get the lending. If we can get that lending, I think that there are real challenges on the government side as well. And you think of some of the challenges they're facing in the East African community, it really comes down to more free flow of people and of services. And you think of harmonizing immigration and making it easier for people to cross border and transport easier for goods to cross border. But I do think it comes with a big burden on the financial services sector to get lending going, particularly to small businesses.
And what changes in that? Why has that not happened already? Why?
It's for some good reason. It's an interesting perspective. This is a bit of a generalization, so it doesn't apply to all. But too often, banks in sub-Saharan Africa, when they take deposits, they can take that money and put them in a domestic treasury bill that yields 13, 14, or 15%, and there's no interest, there's no, excuse me, currency risk. And it's pretty hard to find the incentive to lend to small businesses where there's credit risk and more work, quite frankly, when you can earn 1,100, 1,200, 1,300 basis points in lending. It's why we've begun to see in Nigeria and in other countries capital charges put on banks holding domestic T-bills. And I think it's the right public policy, is we have to use both the bankers' recognition of our responsibility to get lending to small businesses, as well as public policy in line to produce greater incentives to lend. Maybe it means some form of credit guarantee as well to reduce that spread between the T-bill level and the lending level. But I think, unsurprisingly, part of the burden is on the banks and part of the burden is on the governments.
I mean, Michael, this seems like there's a big role for getting, there's a big part of this is getting Africa in more fully involved in the international capital markets then and allowing some of the things that Bob's talked about to happen.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And when you listen to the comments made by colleagues here on the panel, you see that some of these issues, in varying degrees, exactly the same issues in the European Union. Mm. Now, so, for example, I think it's interesting to reflect that we've already seen some of the benefits. We were talking yesterday, someone was telling me, making the comparison that with the sort of free movement that you have and one single market, a truck goes from Frankfurt to Nice in one day. In Africa, that would take 8 to 9 days, because we have to get across some of the practical issues. Similarly, because, you know, the free movement of labor, I'm really encouraged to hear what you say about West Africa. Clearly, you know, free movement of labor has been a massive benefit to the European Union, and yet people are really politically disturbed by it at the moment because they feel that immigration is causing damage to their standard of living and their jobs. You know, as you know, in the UK, we pretty much have an entirely fact-free debate about immigration. So somewhere in about this is, I think, trying to link, and I'm coming to the capital markets point, that bringing people together and understanding why free trade lifts people out of poverty and creates jobs and creates investment, and that free movement of labor is not a threat if handled properly, is something we need to share. And similarly, you know, I think it's fantastic that Johannesburg here in South Africa does have a strong capital market. It links closely to London. London is part of the European Union, hopefully will remain so. And I think those issues, exactly, Bob, the same problem in the European Union about getting lending to SMEs, you know, for different reasons, because we're not getting the 13% returns on T-bills, some of they're negative, you know, actually because of regulatory and capital and other requirements and risk issues and lack of confidence, we've got exactly the same issues. How do we get SMEs who really create jobs to get the financing they need to expand? And we haven't cracked that, even in terms of single financial market.
I mean, you referenced there some of the political tensions that are caused by opening borders, and that's evidenced here in South Africa as well, isn't it, most recently with levels of violence we've seen. Michael was referring there, Yonov, to the case that needs to be made for the benefits of trade. The WTO, this is your bread and butter, selling the benefits of trade. Where do you see in Africa resistance to trade? Where are there still groups of people, perhaps, who don't see the benefits that you see?
Well, I think the benefits are there. And I think all African countries are active in trade. And we know that over the past two or three decades, trade has been able to lift a lot of the population of the world out of poverty. For Africa, I think the challenge remains recognition of what needs to be done. If you listen to the discussion so far, we seem to be touching on bits and bits of sectoral policies. But trade policy is not about one sector. It's a microeconomic policies across sectors woven into one whole.
So trade can't just sit on its own in a silo.
No, it can't. It's got to influence
every other bit of government policy.
So that is why, for instance, for Africa as we stand now, first, you need to be sure you integrate into the multilateral trading system. You are part of the global economy. If you look at our past, most of African exports were under preferential trade regimes. Those regimes are going. So there will be preference erosion. They will be competing with exports from other countries. In the EU, we now have the EPS. Even for the US, where the Agah has been extended, you cannot be sure of another extension. So the future for Africa is making sure that institutions like the WTO work. It's making sure that you create also the domestic environment. Trade today is no longer about your border measures. Trade has moved to behind the border measures. I will bring my capital into your country if I look at your investment regime and it's favorable. I will bring my capital into your country if intellectual property regime is the right framework. So bankruptcy, in some of our countries, people cannot even redeem contracts easily. So when you look at your overall domestic environment and reform it, targeted at specific sectors, and you could get to what is now called exchanging domestic reform for factories. Then you can now get the diversification you need. You can now become more competitive. So concluding the Doha round, for instance, for Africa is very key in providing a stable environment. Implementing the current trade facilitation agreement, which is now backed in capitals for ratification, is key. And you know that Africa is going to host the next ministerial conference in December. So how does Africa now project itself to the international community that it has come to accept those domestic reforms that will enable it to benefit from the international trading system?
Can I take us on to talk about harmonizing free trade agreements? And we've touched on this with some of the deals that are going to be coming through soon. And Fatima, you were mentioning the continental free trade area, and there are things in the works, things are happening, things are moving in Africa. But maybe, Yonov, I could ask you, I mean, what is, from the WTO's perspective, what is the optimal size of a trade area these days? Because we're sitting here on this panel talking about free trade across Africa at a time when Europe and the US are busy negotiating, you know, halfway around the world on TTIP or TTP, big global trade deals. And then we bring things more local and we say in Africa, look, Egypt is signing deals with this part of Africa and that part of Africa. And it's held up as a good thing because it's bringing down borders. But where should the focus be right now? There seem to be lots of actors at lots of different levels.
I think that is not a question for the WTO to answer. It is based on the priorities of the members. But from a conceptual point of view, any improvement or increase in trade, whether between two countries, or whether at the regional level, or at the multilateral level, is important. So if South Africa and Nigeria can take a bilateral trade agreement that improves trade between them, it's good for the world, it's good for the common good. Mm-hmm. If Africa can successfully implement a continental free trade area is good. And that is why in the WTO, we have recognition for all these regional trade agreements, although they need to meet certain minimum conditions to at least ensure that there is no trade diversion, there is no impairment of the trade rights of other countries. So the priority as to how you adopt an approach is dependent on the member. I think for Africa, most of our industries are not really competitive. So as we try to reform, the African market can serve like a testing ground where you now grow and then you can go out into the rest of the global markets. But I think the key is beginning to look at those domestic reforms. We're talking of labor mobility and talent. I was at an event in Abidjan last week, and somebody was saying it's very easy for an African diplomat with his diplomatic passport to get easy access into any African country. But it's very difficult for an African businessman.
So you need to make everybody a diplomat?
Hand out more diplomatic passports? The member states, for instance, may consider giving business passports an African business passport. For instance, in ECOWAS now, you could have your normal national private passport, but it's deemed to be an ECOWAS passport. So it's respected by each ECOWAS member state.
So this is one region of Africa where you can travel freely.
Exactly. So you can take that example and say, okay, for all Africa at the AU level, take a decision. All business people should have a business passport. So I don't need a visa to come into South Africa as a businessman. I can jump on the plane, go and do my deal and get out at the next minute. So these are things we need to begin to look at. We need to also, part of the challenges now is also standards. Standards are not just the ones that the governments are putting in place. Some of them are becoming private standards. So when you look at some of the big retail chains, they have their standards. So African countries also begin to see how they can build centers of excellence across sectors, across production lines, to begin to benefit or at least understand how these standards work and how they can perform in those markets.
I mean, Fatima, it seems there's no shortage of ambition. Trying to set up the continental free trade area is a huge undertaking. Is it possible to deliver this by 2017?
I think it's possible. The reason for it is that, yes, it is an ambitious continental free trade area, and we're also looking for something ambitious. Now, we're not just looking for trade in goods, we're looking for trade in services, we're looking for later on procurement and so forth, but it's possible because one is a head of state and government decision. That's the first one. So it's not an African Union, all the African Union decision are head of state decision. Two is there is, as I said, there is a high-level trade committee which is composed of 8 head of state chairing the regional economic communities that will come every 6 months, will review the progress, will advise on the next step to, forward. Three is we're launching the continental free trade area here in South Africa, from 14 to 15 on the summit. So we're launching the negotiation, actually, of the continental free trade area. But all these things is built on what is existing already on the regional economic communities. As I said, the tripartite, they're going to launch their free trade area 10th of June in Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. So I think this is a very, very important. It's 26 countries. They represent about 57% of GDP of Africa. So I think that is very, very important. It's a very encouraging news. Mr. Agah talked about, the ECOWAS region, like the West African region, is 15 countries. They have a common external tariff. They have free movement of people. They have, an ECOWAS passport. Now they're talking about a common identity. I think that it's also very important for the EU to learn from best practices. How do we learn and make sure that we, move forward? The East African communities, they have, good trade facilitation. They also have the passport. So I think it's very important. So for us, is we want to make sure that we build on best practices, not copying everything from the REC, of course, but copying best practices. How do we ensure that we move and propagate? The other thing that is very important also, I think there is no free trade area today of a region that is 54 countries. The closest thing is the WTO. So that's why actually we're working very closely with the WTO to understand the challenges and also see, how we can be advised. But if you look at the EU is, 27 countries, but they didn't get up in one day and all the 27 countries were ready and then they went for their,
I think the EU is still on a steep learning curve.
Right. So what I'm saying is I think that it's important to see, what are the coalition of the champion that are ready, that they want to move and go, and then the later on, the other can join. I think that's also an option, and we should also look at for this option. And I want to give a very, very an example, which is very crucial. The head of state and government in 2000, in Yamoussoukro, in Ghana, they decided about a single aviation market for Africa. At that time, the market share for Africa was 60%. Now, because of non-implementation, today our market share declined to 20%.
But why was that not implemented then? So there's an agreement between all of these responsible parties that there's going to be free movement in air travel, but then it didn't happen. Why does it not happen?
I think there are a lot of maybe that, actually some of the debate that we have is we take a lot of decision at the African Union level, and maybe that by the time our head of state reached the airport, they forget most of them. So actually we're really kind of sorry about that. We're actually trying to think about, do we need to do really, one summit that is about decision and one summit about implementation. And implementation happen also at all the levels. I mean, from national to regional and also, you know, continental.
So people need to be held to account.
Yes, I think it's very important. And, for the aviation market, what I was saying is that now, head of state, I mean, 15 countries, this sign are willing to say that we're moving. Now, when the rest of you are ready, you can join us. So I think this is also an example you can use for the CFT.
Mm-hmm. I think I would like to add that in financial services, there are big successes which people are not talking about. You take UBA, Ecobank, BGFI, Equity Bank. Those banks are banking around. You know, they are banking cross-border. They're opening branches, they're opening subsidiaries in other countries, and it works. So they are just leading the integration. You also see some big African corporate conglomerates that are also expanding in the continent. Dangote is a name that comes all the time, but it's not the only one. There are several. You see from Morocco, many companies going down in West Africa.
So what do we learn from that? What is it about the banking sector or about businesses like Dangote's that mean that those businesses are able to go across border so much more easily than others?
I think if you just unleash the business community, they will do it. Right now, what is really slowing down, in my view, the business community to do business across the continent are really authorities, government. The business people, they don't have any problem of borders. They would just go where they can make money. Mm-hmm. So we need just to unleash the area and people will go and do business around.
So it seems that maybe, Bob, there are, particularly in the banking sector, examples of where cross-border business is being done very successfully in Africa.
Yes, there's absolutely some success stories, but I would also say there are more examples of banks in sub-Saharan Africa in multiple countries that run them as silos, just a series of separate banks. And one of our ambition is very bold. It's to be one of the leading financial institutions in sub-Saharan Africa. So as we acquire banks in different countries, the plan is to integrate them into a single brand over time and a single technology. And I think, Anna, that's the key, technology. And if banking in Africa can apply the kind of technology, not mobile phone technology, which is critically important for banking the unbanked, for reaching people that can't reach branches, but for the small business community, and you use the example of Dangote, a bank has to understand how much exposure they have to Dangote cement, not just in Nigeria, but in the 17 other countries he operates in as well. My partner, Ashish Dakar, has businesses in 19 countries. And one of his stories about being banked is he was banked in each country separately rather than as an integrated group. There is technology available now, intelligent layer of technology that can help us understand how much credit exposure we have to clients in different countries, how much interest rate exposure we have, but most importantly, how much currency exposure we have because of the cross-border business. How much is in dollars? How much is in domestic? And most importantly, what is that doing to the risk profile of our clients and our customers, the businesses that are doing business, sometimes doing it in dollars, sometimes doing it in local currency? In the agricultural sector, we're going to have to help our customers hedge not just their interest rate exposure, their crop exposure, but also their currency exposure. So it gets quite complex. And one of the things we're beginning to see, and I think it's very positive, is that banks that are in multiple countries are beginning to integrate and operate more as one bank in sub-Saharan Africa rather than a series of separate retail and commercial banks. And I do think it's positive, I do think there's success, but I think we're at the very, very early stages, and the truth is, it's hard work. Mike mentioned the situation in Europe, which has nothing to do with higher interest rates. We need to have the incentives to create the work that's required to understand more about sectors like agriculture, but also the types of companies, the small businesses that are going to become our big businesses are going to be. But that's what truly gets at creating jobs and creating economic growth. So I think the, you know, as we put effort into this, we're going to see the rewards in the financial services industry, but across businesses in Africa as well.
One of the things we haven't talked much about, Mike, is about infrastructure and the need for that. I don't just mean, I mean, there's the obvious infrastructure, there's power infrastructure, electricity being reliable, there's roads and rail, there's also telecoms infrastructure, all of that, well, certainly the latter one of those close to your heart.
Yep. I mean, absolutely, and I think infrastructure, in its broadest sense, is a huge challenge for Africa and important, as you were saying, Fatima, and I think that telecommunications technology is absolutely critical to doing the things that Bob's talking about. And if you look at the need for corporates and others and individuals to have access now to superfast broadband and fiber optics and resilient, secure systems to bank across a region or across a country, this is something that really, how you have to create the environment. And as was being said earlier, and I think by Fatima, it's interesting that, you know, where government and business have the same problem, strategy, relatively speaking, is easy. Execution is difficult. More companies fail on execution than strategy. Mm-hmm. But if then you can free up the environment for business to operate, you know, as you said, they will go and do it if that environment's there, because then you will get the investment coming across a bigger marketplace to accelerate the need to use different technologies to have the communications you need that are critical to many things, trade, banking, you know, where you want to do it. They're critical actually to education, which is a huge issue. They're critical to medicine, to healthcare. Just about everything is where it can be made more efficient and done more effectively. And here, of course, because of the huge size of this continent, there are particular challenges as to how you do that and how fast you can do, and that's addition to the road system, the aviation, and so on and so forth.
Fatima is funding the infrastructure development. What are your thoughts on that? Because obviously the Chinese have been very instrumental of late. It's no accident that the Chinese broadcasters are here running a panel discussion on funding for infrastructure projects. They've been very instrumental on that, but now the Chinese economy is slowing a bit. Does that show up as one of the concerns of the African Union that, you know, great, we need all this infrastructure, but where's the funding going to come from? Who's going to have the appetite to invest in these projects?
Well, the African Union is not looking particularly for the Chinese to come in and help them with infrastructure. I think the African Union is trying to look at all the partnership that we have and really understand what is strategic for us, what is a win-win partnership that we should have. You know, some of the projects, these are bankable projects. How do we ensure that, you know, we have the, you know, public-private, you know, to kind of come and invest? I think that is very important. I think that Africa understand that no country in the world come in and industrialize or, you know, transform their infrastructure because a country came in and helped them. So I think that this is a realization that we are very well aware of. We're looking at this banking sector to understand how do we collaborate also with the banking to ensure that we're moving forward and so forth. I think this is very important. We're going to have a big event this year about especially SMEs and women. Because, you know, the issue of credit, the issue of collateral, you know, some women don't have land, all these things, how do we move with these things? And yes, as a Chinese, we did sign a memorandum of agreement with the Chinese about, you know, especially railway and highway and so forth, but really we wanted to do it our way. And this is really not something that the Chinese are coming to finance us. We're really looking for banking with some type of, you know, how do we learn best practices? And we don't want to copy also the model of Chinese. We want to look at the model of the China, you know, how China came to that point and how other came and come up with our own model that is feasible to our own situation. We're talking about high-speed train, for example. Why we're saying high-speed train? Because we're saying that when Europe had their train, we know the technology is not where it is today. China, when they have it, it was not where it is today. So how do we ensure that we move forward and we learn, you know, again, best practices from others? So for us, I think that is very, very clear that we're not looking for China to come in and transform our continent on infrastructure-wise. It's very important that we look at all the partnership, What is strategic? You know, how do we also ensure that we negotiate good contracts that can take also care of this on the mining sector, for example? You know, we're endowed with natural resources. How do we ensure and we move? So I think that these are some of the things that we're really looking for and ensuring that, you know, we really involve the private sector is very key. Involving the private sector on the continental free trade area, we have to create an Africa Business Council whereby we hear, you know, this, you know, the private sector, you know, voice to ensure that, you know, how do we move forward and work together.
Bob.
The China issue or the China example you used is very appropriate in banking as well. The Chinese banks that are active day-to-day in Africa are very helpful. And they're doing exactly what I would expect them to do, and I think anyone would advise them to do, is they expand outside of their country. They follow their customers and clients. They don't get involved, you know, in areas that they don't know. The result of that is that they're financing projects, and they're financing the customer, the Chinese companies that they're familiar with. They're not really developing SME lending.
Yeah.
So we can't count on that, and that's appropriate. That's as it should be. So I think it puts more pressure on the African banks to develop lending to African companies. One of the great things, and there's a wonderful saying coined by an economist a long time ago, the competitive advantage of being behind. And one of the competitive advantages today is there's very little in terms of tools that we need for SME lending that don't exist in banking. They're just incredibly innovative here in this market, but they do exist. And I think this is truly an example where we can take the best of international and the best of local and create something. And no banking system has ever had to face the challenge of 46 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. That is a big challenge, but the tools are there to accomplish it.
We haven't talked so much about the West and the West's role in involving Africa more in global trade. Yonov, is there something here about the way that the West, and there are that covers many places, but the way that the West deals with Africa and making sure that free trade agreements are as free as they could be? Where would you like to see emphasis placed?
Well, I think we need to recognize where we are coming from. I mean, we all know most of African economies are built on colonial structures, which did not quite affect, were not quite affected as at the time of our independence. So if you look at the preference arrangements that were put in place, they were not really the type that you would say will grow the domestic economy. They were the type that we facilitate or not assure that the trade that was there before was not disrupted. So I think, and many of our countries, when even the GATT regime was established, were not at the table. We only joined the GATT at independence. So, but the situation now is Africa has become a big voice in the World Trade Organization. Mm. So we should now begin to strategically look at those areas in the agreements that give us the best, what you call special and differential treatment provisions that take into account our specific economic circumstances. And I think this is where the challenge is. Across Africa, you have different kinds of economies at different kinds of development, levels of development with different challenges. Some of them, like the LDCs in Africa, they're not required to make any obligations. So how do they relate when they belong to maybe a regional economic community with some developing countries like you have in SADC, and then they are being required to make, commitments. So it is, I think it's not a matter of looking up to the West or to the developed countries. We have come a long way now. If you look at what the EU is doing, the EU is signing bilateral or RTAs with many of the Latin American or Asian countries. This automatically means the competitiveness that African countries had, whether you are talking of bananas, the sugar regime, is gone. So where do you go The idea then should be for us to begin to look at what could make us more competitive. And what makes us more competitive goes back to how we do our domestic trade policy reforms, which are the hierarchy of issues we are talking about here. Mm-hmm. Then how do we harness our domestic situation at the continental level? Mm. I think, again, this is where I differ with a lot of what is going on in the EU. We still continue to think of the old classical model where you think that these things will fall in place. You look at convergence criteria. And convergence criteria that nobody knew there would be an Ebola problem that would disrupt the economies of some of the West African countries. Nobody knew that there was going to be a decline in oil prices or commodity prices in general. So if you are looking at GDP, debt ratio, and deficit, you will never converge. So African countries need to recognize that they have to build. It's good, you cannot say, me, I'm poor, I can go and open an account with Dangote, a joint account with Dangote. But you can learn from the European Union mm-hmm. by opening that common currency framework and then saying, you can participate in this framework subject to these conditions. Then each member can join at the time it feels it's ready. But when you go through the classical route, if you look at West Africa, I think we've been struggling to integrate UMOA and ECOWAS for how many years now? It's not working. And even if you go back in Africa's trade history and start looking at the elements of the Lagos Plan of Action, the Abuja Treaty establishing the African economy, they are the same things that we are talking about today.
So you can't just wait forever for these economies to converge and to look similar?
We need to say everybody is different.
Okay.
Everybody, there's no one size fits all, there's no silver bullet. But there could be common good. So what is the common good? And then everybody latches onto that common good as it assesses its abilities and capacity to participate.
Just in concluding then with the panel, I wonder if everybody could think of one final message that they really would like people who are watching, who are listening to this to take away with them. I mean, Bob, maybe we'll start with you. Listening to what you've said already, it seems that incentivizing the banking sector to go out and lend money to small and medium-sized businesses, and I can think of other parts of the world where we've had these conversations recently as well, but in this case, Africa, that seems to be, for you, a big focus.
Yeah, very much. I think it's a key, and I come back to the point I made earlier that intra-regional trade will pave the way for intra-Africa trade. I think we should be cognizant that some of the most important developments are happening within the East African community, within the SADC community, within ECOWAS, within Francophone West Africa. I also think there's a lot of work being done. I think Donald Kabaruki at the African Development Bank has been very, very supportive of fostering lending to small businesses, Afrexim as well. So I think this is truly, you know, a partnership between the private sector and the development finance institutions and the government. I think there's a lot for everyone to do here. Mm. But the goal, everyone should say, is what's good for creating jobs and for creating economic growth.
Jean-Louis.
Yes, the key word that I would like us to retain here is transformation. We need really to transform African economies. We can't continue with this model of exporting raw commodities. It's unsustainable. So to transform, the environment is now conducive for that. You have those economic communities that have been set up. We should make them work. It's not for government to go and sign something and renege on it when they come back home. They should be accountable for that.
Fatima.
I think Africa will surprise the world. We're going to have our continental free trade area, which is ambitious, good services, people. I think it's very important. This upcoming summit will discuss, actually, at the closed session with the head of state and government, the movement of people, because I think that this migration issue is very, very important. The structural transformation of Africa is imperative. We need to create job in Africa, as he said. The commodity export is not good for us because our population are growing, and we need to make sure that we create job for our people. And lastly thing is, I think that education is very, very important for our people, because this continent have a lot of youth, and I think that if we don't treat them, they will be a threat to us and also to the world. But if we treat them, I think that they will truly develop this continent. So I think that this is what we're going to be working on, and the deadline of 2017 will be respected. Thank you.
Yeah. Right. No, I think Kabinia, I think Africa is at a crossroads. I think it's an enormous continent with enormous resources, great demographics, big challenges. And at a practical level, I would say, and all the things you're talking about, free movement of labor, currency union, regulatory convergence, learn from the good things the European Union did and learn from their mistakes in these areas. And remember that success leads to further problems on immigration as you complete that market. Mm. That would be my suggestion.
Yonov.
Well, I think, Anna,
Fatima's confident 2017, well, she'll get the continental free trade area. You're not so.
I have to go back to my initial proposition. Africa's future has to respond to the current global economic environment. So we need to begin to think of going into processes that help us. And I'm not doing a commercial for the WTO, but I would want to believe that the multilateral trading system provides the best environment for small economies like in Africa or the national governments to get good trade deals rather than the current approach through to have some bilateral and regional trade agreements with developed countries. Secondly, based on these prevailing international environment, you need to begin to strategically reform. Not reform for its sake, reforms that give priority to those, the drivers of growth. Reforms that are sequenced, reforms that are properly timed and monitored to ensure that both national governments and the continent as a region benefits from its participation in international trading system.
Okay, thank you all very much for some fascinating ideas there to take away with us. So the need, small economies in particular, the need to band together to get better trade deals, the importance of learning from other unions around the world, such as the EU, the good and the bad that have been done there. The importance of maybe the free trade area, continental free trade area, and the importance of migration in there for both Africa and also, from what you said, Fatima, for Europe too. The importance of diversifying the African economy away from commodities and the importance of lending to business, all of those themes coming out very strongly in the conversation. So thank you all very much for participating today here at the World Economic Forum for Africa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.